Bom dia a todos. Obrigado por vocês estarem aqui. É um privilégio a gente estar hoje reabrindo esse evento que a gente começou há 15 anos. Eu quero começar agradecendo a Cinemateca Brasileira por estar, mais uma vez, sendo a sede da conferência. Quero agradecer demais a presença da fundadora, quem teve a ideia de fazer essa conferência há 15 anos atrás. Dentro da Tudo Verdade, foi a professora Maria Dora Mourão, que está aqui à direita, e hoje é a nossa principal conselheira. E é graças a ela que essa conferência persistiu por tanto tempo. E estamos aqui recomeçando depois de uma pausa chamada freio de arrumação no ano passado. Me pareceu uma oportunidade única. A gente, um festival que se chama É Tudo Verdade, foi inspirado pelo It's All True, do Orson Welles, no centenário do Orson Welles, ter aqui um dos principais especialistas americanos na obra do Orson Welles, um dos grandes críticos de cinema em atividade nos Estados Unidos. Talvez o último grande livro publicado sobre o Orson Welles é dele, que é o Discovering Orson Welles, onde ele reúne uma série de artigos e ensaios que ele, durante mais de 25 anos, publicou a respeito do Orson Welles. E não é à toa que se chama Discovering Orson Welles, porque ele ilumina aqueles escaninhos mais misteriosos e desconhecidos da carreira do Welles. E particularmente para a gente, num festival de documentários, como na fala que ele vai fazer agora, como a gente vai ver, ele foi um dos pioneiros a melhor examinar as relações entre Orson Welles e a não-ficção. Não apenas nos filmes mais famosos de não-ficção que Orson Welles fez, como o It's All True, que ficou inacabado, e o Effort Fake, que foi o filme testamento dele, ambos a gente está exibindo nesse festival, mas como nas outras, em toda a produção, para além, inclusive, da cinematográfica do Orson Welles. Ele é tem livros publicados sobre Kiarostami, sobre a produção dele, do Jonathan, é imensa. Ele é de Chicago, ele foi crítico do Chicago Reader durante muito tempo. Hoje em dia ele tem um blog, tem um site, www.jonathanrosenbaum.com, que eu recomendo a todo mundo, para quem quer seguir o que acontece na cena cinematográfica internacional. E para a gente é a primeira vez que ele vem a São Paulo. Então é uma grande honra para mim ter ao meu lado, para a palestra inicial desse encontro, o Jonathan Rosenbaum. Thank you, Jonathan, for being here. Muito obrigado por estar aqui. Agradecendo a presença de todos, eu passo a palavra a Mr. Jonathan Rosenbaum. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Amir. And as he explained to you, I'm much happier having a dialogue than offering a monologue. So I invite you not only to ask questions, but also if you have comments, if you have arguments, I hope we can be more of a back and forth, because I think it's very dangerous for any person to claim to be or pretend to be an Orson Welles expert. I think one of the things I hope to be discussing is how fiction and nonfiction are not only a dialectic in the work of Orson Welles, they're almost like a snake eating its own tail. That the reason why I called my book Discovering Orson Welles is because it's a continuing process to discover Orson Welles. It's not something that we can suddenly say, we have all of Orson Welles now, the way we have a complete set of Charles Dickens or a complete set of Tolstoy on the shelf, and that it's all there. We're never going to reach this point with Orson Welles. And he always has a lot of secrets up his sleeve. And one of the approaches in my book, in fact, was to combine a certain form of fiction and nonfiction, because rather than correct all of my factual errors that were in that I learned about in some of my earlier pieces, I kept these pieces exactly as I'd written them, and then I added the correction in the commentary, so that you can't pick this up and just sort of read one little thing and know that that's the truth, because then there'll be another commentary before it that'll say, I was mistaken when I wrote this. I think our mistakes are very important. They're not just simply missteps, but they're part of the process of discovery. And in line with this, I want to begin as a sort of motto for my remarks, a statement Wells made in an interview in 29th of January, 1938, very much like near the beginning of his career. I mean, he was 23 years or 22 years old at the time he made it. He said, "I want to give the audience a hint of a scene, no more than that. Give them too much and they won't contribute anything themselves. Give them just a suggestion and you get them working with you. That's what gives the theater meaning when it becomes a social act." And this was like in the magazine Collier's in, as I mentioned, January 1938. So I think that's very much important, that even though Wells is a mysterious secret figure, he is someone for whom all of his work is a social act. And it's a social act in which our imaginations plays as great a role as anything that he does. It's a kind of play between our imaginations and his magic, you could say. Now, I'm going to be talking about nonfiction and more than just film, because I think it's an important part of his career as a whole that he did a lot of things involving nonfiction and documentary. For instance, in the mid-1940s, he wrote a daily newspaper column for the New York Post. And these columns have not been published, unfortunately, since they came out in the 40s. And some of them are very dated. Most of them are very dated. They're about current events. They include the kinds of things that very casual newspaper writing would include. Recipes, you know, household hints, astrology tips. And in fact, I'm going to read, some of them are very interesting. A few columns he wrote, for example, about films are especially interesting because, for example, he got very interested and enthusiastic about a very low-budget B film that came out in this period, directed by William Castle, called When Strangers Marry. And he also wrote a very interesting column in which he got to see an early screening of Sergei Eisenstein's Ivan the Terrible. And he wrote one or two columns comparing that to a big biographical period film from Hollywood called Wilson. And so these were among the more ambitious columns. Now I'm going to read you one entire column that he wrote, which is appearing on the screen behind me. And I thought it might be of particular interest because most of it deals with Carnival here. And this is a column he wrote on and published on Tuesday, February 13th, 1945. And I'll read all of it to you because it gives you a sense of what these columns were like. Moon, Pluto Quincarox. This is New Year's Day in China. Foreign. Since the outbreak of the war, Hitler has conferred a golden badge for hand-to-hand fighting on all soldiers who have engaged in at least 50 hand-to-hand fights in combat. Last week, every wearer of this badge was ordered to the home front for secret duty. These desperate thugs are a part of the Berlin Reception Committee. They will be prowling the streets of Germany disguised as civilians to harass the Allied army of occupation. Domestic. He's tried to keep it quiet, but Major Roger Lapham of San Francisco, who is a top steamship line official, fought Harry Bridges back in 1934, has been trying to persuade Washington to drop deportation proceedings against the labor leader. Today is Shrove Tuesday or Pancake Tuesday and the last day of the Carnival season. whether carnival means something more than a Ferris wheel, wherever carnival means something more than a Ferris wheel and a shooting gallery. Now, there are some who disapproved of carnivals because they think it is only an excuse for getting drunk. I was in Rio 3 years ago for the last great carnival in that greatest of carnival cities. And I saw with these two eyes a couple of million people dancing and singing in the streets. Most of them didn't even go to bed for 3 days. And nobody anywhere in that enormous jamboree stopped celebrating long enough to take a drink. I can't tell you about it. They'll have carnival again after the war, and you'll have to fly down there and see it for yourself. It's brighter than a circus, bigger than the World Series, and louder than the 4th of July. It is all of those good times rolled into one. It's New Year's Eve, Halloween night, and Christmas morning. It's wild and it's gay, and it's absolutely sober, because at carnival you don't need liquor to help you forget you're getting old. You're too busy remembering what it was like when you were young. Carnival isn't a religious observance, but it is fundamentally the celebration of religious people. Wherever the money changers have taken over, carnival is no more. Wherever work is so hard that a holiday means rest instead of a good time, carnival is only a word for a tent show. You have to save up for carnival. You have to save something of yourself out of the business year. You have to play hard at carnival, not in contest with anybody, not for points and a score. Carnival calls for the aimless exuberance of childhood. And if you never felt like dancing around and making a fool of yourself in a funny hat, you won't know what I'm talking about and you don't care. Maybe next year there will be dancing in the streets. If you don't approve, we'll confront you with Shakespeare, who wrote a play called Twelfth Night. There's a blue-nosed Puritan in Twelfth Night who objects to the noisy roustering of some other people who happen to be having a little fun. One of these carnival characters turns to the censor with the deathless and unanswerable question, "Dost thou think that because thou art virtuous, there shall be no more cakes and ale?" And that's all of that particular column. Because he ends with Twelfth Night, I wanted to actually play next for you something that's a real curiosity that's not very well known today. In 1938, which was the same year as War of the Worlds, the famous broadcast in which adapted from H.G. Wells, when a lot of people were persuaded that Martians had actually really invaded the world, the Earth and the United States. Wells had a project that was called Everybody's Shakespeare with his school teacher in boarding school, Roger Hill. And it was the idea of making Shakespeare more accessible to the general public, of making Shakespeare mainstream, which of course Shakespeare was in America in the 19th century before he became, there's a theory that only when the middle class sort of became more prominent that Shakespeare became esoteric to people. Wells did entire productions of four Shakespeare plays for an audio, not for radio, but he recorded them released on 78 RPM records. And this was accompanied by four books that which were editions of Shakespeare with introductions by Roger Hill and by Orson Welles, and drawings by Orson Welles giving suggestions about the costumes, the sets, and things like this. But the whole idea was to encourage people not only just to read Shakespeare, but to perform Shakespeare. And these were very elaborate productions. And what's really interesting about what I'm going to play for you is when he did Twelfth Night, he did an additional prologue and epilogue, which are kind of like early examples of what you might call pseudo-documentary style. The same style that he would use 4 months later or 5 months later on War of the Worlds, before he was even thinking of doing War of the Worlds, he was very interested in the form and the style of things like news broadcasts and how they conveyed an impression of the truth. And he wanted to convey a lot of information about Shakespeare and the times in which the play came out. And so as a kind of pedagogical device, he created a prologue documentary about Shakespeare, about the original production. And that's what I want you to hear now, that's going to be played for you. It's a very old recording from 1938, and if you don't understand every word, it's okay, because it's difficult for even people who speak English to understand it all. But I think it's very interesting to get a general impression of what he's doing in this very elaborate audio production of Twelfth Night. So this is about, as I say, about 8 minutes long. Okay, I think one of the important points to make about this prologue, which, by the way, there was also an epilogue that he recorded in which he talks about a history of critical reactions to Twelfth Night by various critics over the, you know, several centuries, is that Wells is doing two things which are kind of almost a contradiction. He's speculating, almost you can say the way that science fiction is speculative, about what conversation might have taken place between Richard Burbage and William Shakespeare. But then he's also trying to educate the audience and to convey a lot of information, which sort of is a different agenda, obviously, because the conversation they had, they didn't need to impart all this information, except, you know, because they already knew a lot of the things that they're talking about. So he combines these two things, and then he comes along and tells you, well, maybe it wasn't exactly like that. Maybe it was the day before, maybe it was the day after, maybe this was not the exact words used. He's doing precisely the kind of thing he says about getting the audience and their imagination involved, first by giving them a fiction and then telling them, well, maybe it wasn't exactly like that. We have to adjust and we don't really know what happened. And it seems to me that this is very much comparable to what he did in War of the Worlds. It's very interesting that period fiction historical fiction is parallel in many ways to science fiction. Because if you're going and if you're trying to sort of figure out what's going to happen in the future, it's similar in a way to going into the past. And that's why I think it's very logical, for example, in the career of Stanley Kubrick, you can say that 2001 and Barry Lyndon are not as different as one might first assume, that they're both films about curiosity, curiosity about the past, curiosity about the future. And similarly, even the two films, the only two features made by Kevin Brownlow, the film historian, one of them is a science fiction film about what happened if World War II were lost to the Germans. And then he made a historical film called When Stanley. And they're really two forms of, you could say, science fiction of the past and science fiction of the future. And I think in delving into the time of Shakespeare, and this was recorded, the whole Twelfth Night recording, and by the way, all of these Shakespeare, the four Shakespeare plays he did, including this prologue and epilogue, are still available on CD from an you could probably get them, I believe, from English Amazon. They might even be available elsewhere online. But they're not very well known about today, even though they're very ambitious, serious productions and more elaborate than any of his, in some ways, even than his radio productions. And of course, the cast are the Mercury Players, the same actors who turn up in Citizen Kane and Magnificent Ambersons and so on.
Eu gostaria de share uma palavra com você. É um grande prazer ouvir tudo aquilo que você tem a dizer. É, para começarmos, gostaria de share a palavra real fiction, que é algo que surgiu para mim. Real fiction. Obrigada.
Yes. Well, I think the idea of yes, sorry, I have to learn to alternate these. Yes, I think the idea of real and fiction belong together in a certain way in the world of Wells, because I think that it's similarly, I think that there's a kind of, I think that, you know, one thing that's interesting about the whole history of cinema is we like to think that there's a very clear distinction between documentary, which we associate with the Lumiere brothers, and fiction, which we associate with Georges Méliès. But Georges Méliès made newsreels also. He would do restagings of actual important events with actors and so on at the, right after they happened. So they were really a kind of documentaries, and was, it's been argued, for example, Jean-Luc Godard, you look at the subjects of the Lumiere brothers' films, and they're the same subjects as Impressionist painting. So that there's a certain kind of way in which, and there are things that are obviously organized for the camera, so that there's a certain fictional element in Lumiere's films, you know, some of which include slapstick, early slapstick, you know, somebody stepping on a hose and, you know, and so on. So the point is that we'd like to pretend that there's a clear division at the beginning of cinema between fiction and documentary, but there isn't. They're kind of commingling from the very beginning of cinema. And it seems to me, I have a theory that the most progressive cutting edge films being made today and throughout the history of cinema are films in which we can't clearly say that they're either fiction or nonfiction. That they combine the two. And I mean, a good current example of this, I think in a certain way, is a film I believe that's either playing now in Brazil or is about to, maybe in Rio, which is Citizen Four by Laura Poitras, which is a real documentary and I think is truthful, and yet it's a movie, it's not a film. And Edward Snowden and Glenn Greenwald come across like movie stars, not like normally what would we would see as the protagonists in a documentary.
O filme está sendo exibido no festival, está sendo lançado no festival. O Citizen Four já teve uma sessão em São Paulo, vai ter outra sessão em São Paulo no final de semana. It's not released in Brazil, the premiere is in our program. Yeah.
Yes. Oh, well, that's very good to know, and I recommend it to everybody here very much. I think it's a really exciting film, precisely for the reasons of exploring this kind of constant contradiction that's part of the legacy of cinema. Because after all, what we regard as fiction and nonfiction is not, and again, it relates back to what Wells said in that statement about the audience, that it's what's in people's heads, it's not just what's on the screen. When we look at a lot of things that we think are, you know, real, what's real is based on conventions which change over time. So when we look at, you know, like a classic of early documentary like La Nuca of the North, how does it begin? It begins like a circus act with all this family getting out of, you know, a canoe that's almost like with all of these clowns getting out of a car. And it becomes like show business, in other words.
Bom dia, Sr. Rosenbaum. Eu gostaria que o senhor falasse um pouco mais sobre o paralelo que o senhor fez entre War of the Worlds, a Guerra dos Mundos, e esse prólogo que nós ouvimos. Porque, em princípio, me parecem coisas bem diferentes. Uma é um prólogo de uma peça, que claramente é uma coisa teatral, fictícia, e a outra foi transmitida como se fosse algo real que estivesse acontecendo naquele momento. Mas, ainda assim, o senhor vê proximidade, semelhanças entre esses dois dispositivos. Eu gostaria que o senhor falasse um pouco mais sobre isso, por favor.
Yes, of course, the effects of these two different works are radically different. Because War of the Worlds, you know, to what extent Wells wanted to fool the public into thinking it was a real, to what extent that we don't really know exactly, but he was basically wanted to make a polemical point. The first line that Orson Welles utters in Citizen Kane is, "Don't believe everything you hear on the radio." And that's an obvious reference to the War of the Worlds broadcast, because that's what made him famous. And what he was trying to demonstrate, partly with War of the Worlds, is that people will believe certain things. And of course, one technique he uses, which he doesn't use in The Twelfth Night, is you're hearing normal, boring, you know, radio broadcast of an orchestra playing, and it's very slow and boring. And John Houseman, who's Wells' producer at the time, mentioned how everybody complained about the beginning of the broadcast is so slow, and it's, you know, it's going to put people to sleep. But the whole point was to lull them into accepting what they were listening to is real and real radio. And you don't get that, it's true, in Twelfth Night. But what you do have is the form of the pseudo-documentary. And I think that's what's important. I mean, I think that you could see Wells' relation to documentary expressed in two film titles, one of which, of course, is It's All True, and the other of which is F for Fake. Even though he didn't think up the title F for Fake, he decided to keep it after when it was suggested by his partner, Oya Kodar. The one time I met Wells was while he was editing F for Fake, and at the time he said he was editing a movie called Hoax. So he changed it several times. But I think what's interesting is that even though the title suggests we should accept It's All True as being completely truthful and F for Fake as being all lies, one could argue that there is more truthfulness in some ways in F for Fake than there is in It's All True. There's a kind of way in which you can arrive at truth through lies. And there's also ways you can arrive at lies through the truth. Because, I mean, the point is it all depends on what subjectivity is being projected onto the objectivity. And we have to contend not only with the subjectivity of Wells, but our own subjectivity. And then if we wanted to think of War of the Worlds, we have to project ourselves back into the mood of a country that was, you know, suffering from a kind of war nerves or worried about the outbreak of war. And then they hear about this landing of Martians. And it has something to do with the, I guess what's called the zeitgeist. I mean, with the mood of that period. And obviously, as I was saying, they're very different. But what I wanted to suggest was that the technique which you see throughout Wells' career. You see it in the newsreel of Citizen Kane, which is a fake newsreel, is giving fiction an enhancement through trying to make it, by giving it all the techniques that we associated with documentary and real and the real. So basically what I'm talking about is what might be described as fictional documentary. But of course, and It's All True, you have reenactments of things that really happen, and so that becomes fiction too, of a certain kind. So I think what's happening, it seems to me, in the similarity that's most important is, you know, at the end of the War of the Worlds, he comes on the air and assures you, you know, this didn't really happen. The Mars didn't, you know, the Martians didn't, haven't landed. This is a Halloween prank. And there's a similarity when he says, well, maybe this isn't exactly the conversation that took place between Richard Burbage and William Shakespeare. It's just that, you know, something like that. And so we're being almost like invited into his laboratory at the end and said, we have to look at it as a construction, not as reality. So that's what I think the relationship is. Any other questions and comments at this point? Well, I wanted to actually turn next to, what I'm going to be doing for part of the rest of my time is reading from you a couple of things I've written about, specific ideas about nonfiction and fiction in Wells' work. First, I'm almost like a kind of a survey and theoretical essay that I wrote some time ago and was published originally in 1991. And in fact, the quotation I gave you about giving the audience a hint of a scene was the kind of epigraph for this essay, which is called Orson Welles' Essay Films and Documentary Fictions, a Two-Part Speculation. Okay, and I'm only going to read you part of this, and I think part of it, I can't reproduce the form of the essay was kind of like, I was attempting to do something that I guess could be described as mimetic criticism, which is criticism that in some way is trying to imitate the object that's being discussed. So I was this was a very formally playful piece because it was constructed according to certain numbered sections and certain numbers of footnotes, and all of which are sort of like meant to be a dialectic, a sort of a thesis and antithesis. So I begin, okay, two propositions. One of the most progressive forms of cinema is the film in which fiction and nonfiction merge, trade places, become interchangeable. Two, one of the most reactionary forms of cinema is the film in which fiction and nonfiction merge, trade places, become interchangeable. How can both of these statements be true? As in fact, I believe they are. In the final analysis, the issue is an ethical one. In support of number two, there are docudramas that use spurious means to grant bogus authenticity to fiction. And I give as a good example Mississippi Burning, a film which is full of to me as a Southerner, I think is an utterly false depiction of the civil rights movement and struggle. And then there are documentaries that employ fictional devices in order to lie more effectively, such as the studio retakes in Leni Riefenstahl's Triumph of the Will, which are well documented in Albert Speer's Inside the Third Reich, that she would get the speakers at this rally to go back in a studio and give the speeches again to film them, you know, sort of more effectively. So it's no longer a record of an event, which Riefenstahl later claimed was the fact, but in fact a fiction about that event. Okay, in support of one about that this is one of the most progressive forms of cinema, there are masterpieces collapsing, combining, and or juxtaposing fiction and nonfiction in order to facilitate and broaden a filmmaker's grasp on a subject in the interest of truth. This is a highly subjective matter, of course, but a few of my own key touchstones in this category would be, and then I have a list of 12, Joseph von Sternberg's The Saga of an Autochthon, 1953, Alan René and Marguerite Duras's Hiroshima Mon Amour, 1959, Jean-Marie Straub and Daniel Guillet's The Bridegroom, The Comedian, and The Pimp from 1968. Jacques Rivette's Out One from 1971. Orson Welles' F for Fake from 1973. Jacques Tati's last film, Parade, shot on video, 1973. Jean-Luc Godard's Ici et Ailleurs from 1974. Chris Marker's Sans Soleil from 1982. Françoise Romand's Mix-Up from 1985, and Raul Ruiz's documentary about dance, Ma Mom, from 1987. Then Joris Evans and Marceline Loredan's A Tale of the Wind, 1988. And finally, American experimental filmmakers Leslie Thornton's Peggy and Fred in Hell, which at the time I wrote was still in progress. Okay. Two propositions, this is the second part. All of Orson Welles' film and television work can be divided into two categories, fiction and nonfiction. Two, all of Orson Welles' film and television work can be divided into two categories, stories and essays. This leads us into certain semantic problems. from the outset. Stories, after all, can be fictional or non-fictional, and essays can make use of fiction as well as non-fiction. Then there is the equally vexing question of how we even define a work by Orson Welles, which has been addressed in some detail by James Naremore, who, by the way, I should mention, I believe and continue to believe, has written the best book about Orson Welles in any language, which is The Magic World of Orson Welles, and which is coming out in its third edition later this year. So if you're not familiar with it, I very highly recommend it. He also wrote the best book about film noir, I think, and someone who just couldn't stay for this lecture but asked me about a question about, because she's working on a thesis on Orson Welles in relationship to film noir, I suggested she read both books, actually, because I think it's, Naremore is to me my favorite American academic film scholar. Okay, if we include only works that were both completed and public shown by Welles, we narrow our scope considerably. If we decide to broaden our list, we invariably come up with a different set of problems. Okay, let us try to make do with four separate lists, all of them necessarily somewhat tentative and complete, none of which includes the now lost films done by Welles as interludes in many of his stage productions, but still comprising two dozen works in all. Okay, A, nonfiction or essay films by Welles that were completed and shown. The Citizen Kane trailer, made around 1940, which, by the way, if you haven't seen it, is made up completely of separate footage. There's no single shot from Citizen Kane in it, but it was done separately. The Orson Welles sketchbook, which was done for BBC TV in 1955, which were 6 15-minute programs. Around the World with Orson Welles, ITA TV, 1955, 6 26-minute programs. Most of these are actually available on DVD, although not many people know about them.
Só para comentar isso que você falou, o trailer, o trailer estava em uma das versões do Citizen Kane em DVD ou no Blu-ray, está disponível, dos três que ele citou. O segundo, que é o sketchbook, vocês podem assistir alguns online no YouTube. Não todos, mas acho que 3 ou 4 tem no YouTube. E o Around the World with Orson Welles, nós exibimos aqui no festival em 2002 e foi lançado, eu acho que numa cópia pirata, por uma distribuidora em DVD aqui no Brasil há mais ou menos 5 ou 6 anos atrás.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. Next on the list is, let me give my bad Italian pronunciation, Nella Terra di Don Quixote, The Land of Don Quixote, which was made for RAI, Italian TV in 1964, which is 9 30-minute programs. These are kind of like home movies done by Welles in Spain. It's not a major work by any means, but unfortunately, when a finished version was edited by Jesus Franco of Don Quixote, the disastrous decision was made to include portions of this series as if it were Don Quixote. And with the result that I think the version that's commercially available of Don Quixote does more damage to Welles' original conception than even the release version of Magnificent Ambersons did to his conception of that film and or any of his other projects.
Só para comentar que essa versão que ele está falando do Don Quixote é essa que nós infelizmente também temos em versão pirata no Brasil.
Okay, F for Fake is next on the list, 1973. Filming Othello, which is the last completed and released film by Orson Welles, 1978, although it's not too well known. That's very much in the form, even more than F for Fake, of an essay film. B list, nonfiction or essay films by Welles that were completed but not publicly shown. A condensed first act of Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest and the last scene of Shakespeare's Henry IV, which he filmed a record of the performances in Munich in 1950, but then he didn't like them, so he discarded them. Orson Welles and People, an independently produced television pilot about the life of Alexander Dumas, 27 minutes long, around 1956. He actually threw this away after he couldn't get anybody interested in it. But I spoke to one person who had seen it, who said it actually wasn't very good, who was a friend of Wells. Portrait of Gina, which actually is also known as Viva l'Italia, which was a early version of kind of like an essay film, which was a very playful nonfiction film about contemporary Italy in 1958, including, it sort of culminates in, with an interview with Gina Lollobrigida, but there's also an interview with Victoria De Sica in it and others. And this exists today, but is it's and it was shown on German television at one point.
It is online. It is online. It's also, desculpa. Yeah, está também no YouTube. Há uma cópia dessa versão que passou na Alemanha. Quem sabe colocar Portrait of Gina no YouTube, Orson Welles vai poder ver numa cópia porca que claramente foi gravada da emissão alemã, também interrompida, etc.
Yes. In any case, the reason why it's not commercially available is that Gina Lollobrigida tried to prevent a screening because of, you know, claiming rights over it, I think. Then there's Spying in Vienna, a sketch done for an unshown CBS TV special called Orson's Bag, 1959. This I think part of it exists and is held by the Munich Film Archives, but I think part of it is lost. There's also a missing episode about Vienna and Around the World in 80 Days, but it recently has been, one copy has been found in America in, I believe, in Milwaukee or Madison, but this is going to be shown at one of the many Wells events being held in the Midwest. I think it's going to be hopefully shown if they can set it up. I don't know. But in any case, I'm glad to know that it does survive. And finally in this list, there's an F for Fake trailer, which again, like Citizen Kane trailer, is made up of completely different, almost completely different materials. And this is available on some DVDs of F for Fake, although it was never processed. It's a remains as a work print because the original producer of the trailer refused to spend the money for processing it because they felt they couldn't show a 9-minute trailer in movie theaters. Okay, my list C is nonfiction or essay films that were started but not completed. Of course, the most obvious of these is It's All True from 1942. Second is Moby Dick Rehearsed, a film record of his London stage performance, which was actually considered by many one of his greatest stage productions and most inventive, and that was from 1955. There have been rumors about the footage of that surviving somewhere, but I haven't seen any evidence of them turning up, so I tend to think that they haven't survived, but we don't know for sure.
We have the que nós temos é a peça publicada, né? Se a gente é provavelmente a gente não tem imagens disso, mas nos Estados Unidos o texto do Mob Deep Rehearsed foi publicado, é disponível. Se forem a Amazon.com, vocês acham o texto do Orson Welles.
Yes, and it's a wonderful idea for an adaptation because it's all set in the 19th century on a bare stage where they're rehearsing a production. But it's a perfect example of Welles' genius in using the audience's imagination because he conjures up people on a ship at sea, all kinds of things. And he has somebody doing sound effects in the back of the stage. And in fact, there's a wonderful moment, because I saw one production of this once, where you see a man sawing a piece of wood as a sound effect for somebody miming sawing a piece of wood in the foreground.
Só um parênteses, já que estamos falando de Moby Dick. Você leu ou você, quando conversou com Wells, ele comentou com você o que ele achava do filme do John Huston? Ele tem uma cena apenas no filme. O Wells aparece no Moby Dick, na filmagem pelo John Huston nos anos 50, e era um projeto do próprio Wells, ele fazer o filme, e acabou não fazendo, ele fez uma ponta no filme do amigo.
Yes. No, that didn't come up. I did talk, the whole subject of my lunch was literary adaptations in a way, because it was specifically about his first Hollywood film script, Heart of Darkness. And so we talked a lot about Conrad, we talked about Faulkner. One thing I learned that was very interesting, which I don't think has appeared in any interview, is that he told me he was friends with Nathaniel West, the American novelist, when he was in Hollywood, that he used to hang out with Nathaniel West, which was interesting. But he also mentioned, who some of his favorite American novelists were, that he preferred, he said, Fitzgerald, F. Scott Fitzgerald and John O'Hara to William Faulkner. Faulkner was not one of his favorites. He respected him, but he was not one of his favorites. And he liked Hemingway, of course. Next on the list is the Domenici Affair, which is a program that was conceived of around the world with Orson Welles, but was never completed, partly because of censorship difficulties. It was a true crime story in France. But there is a DVD available of a documentary about the unfinished film that shows you a lot of the existing footage and so on.
Nós exibimos isso, The Domenica Fair. Yeah. Nós exibimos esse filme aqui no festival em 2002, quando a gente fez uma parte da uma homenagem à vinda do Orson Welles ao Brasil. Então, é um documentário sobre, chama The Domenica Fair, que a gente já foi exibido no Brasil. A gente não tem o DVD. O DVD está disponível nos Estados Unidos e na França você encontra, mas no Brasil não.
Yeah. Next is The Magic Show, which is a film record of magic performances without camera tricks, which he worked on from approximately between 1969 and 1985. Now, what he did shoot is held by the Munich Film Archive, and there are many excerpts that that you can see in Orson Welles' The One Man Band, which is included as an extra on certain Orson Welles DVDs. And I think what's unfortunate in the compilation that was released by, at one point, or shown at a few occasions by the Munich Film Archives, is that Welles wanted it accompanied by he basically saw it as a kind of like a very silent comedy, a lot of it. And he took out all the comedy, the guy at the Munich Film Archives, included only the magic tricks, but the best parts of the comedy, actually, with Ab Dixon, that are quite funny. And when Ab Dixon came to a Welles event at Locarno, he kind of explained, and he has some of the footage actually himself now, but nobody's tried to put it all together. The final film on this list is Filming the Trial. He was going to do a kind of sequel to Filming Othello about the making of the trial, because the trial, like Othello, was a film that was radically changed from its original conception. Both Othello and the trial were films that were originally planned as studio films that became films done on locations, largely because the financing fell through in both cases. And so he completely reconfigured both films based on those changes. What he did film in Filming the Trial, and it's all he did, was he spent about 90 minutes talking to an audience after a screening of the trial. And Gary Graver filmed it, and the Munich Film Archives has that complete on 16 millimeter. And it's an interesting Q&A, but that's all it is. It's not edited or anything like that. Except, I think it's edited in a kind of perfunctory way by Gary Graver. Finally, the last on my list is fiction films of Orson Welles that utilize documentary or pseudo-documentary or essayistic elements. First of these is Citizen Kane, of course, the pseudo-documentary News on the March segment at the beginning. The Magnificent Ambersons, which begins as a kind of documentary or essay about things like clothing, fashions, and things like this in the American past. The Stranger, which from 1946, which includes documentary footage of concentration camps. Mr. Akkadin begins with a pseudo-documentary prologue about a plane which was seen alone in the sky without a pilot. And Don Quixote had essayistic, unfinished, had essayistic narration, or plan to have essayistic narration. Unfortunately, what remains has very little narration. A wonderful TV pilot that you can see on YouTube, The Fountain of Youth, which was made, actually produced by Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz, who were friends with Wells in the mid-50s, has kind of essayistic narration. And is something that's quite a departure for Wells, and I would strongly recommend, because he used to say that almost all of his scripts, most of his scripts that were not filmed were comedies, and that what he particularly liked to do were comedies, but he never got to actually make comedies, straight comedies, and Fountain of Youth is a straight comedy, even though it's just half an hour, but it's quite wonderful, based on a John Collier story. In Chimes at Midnight, 1966, we get essayistic narration from Holland Shed's Chronicles. And finally, the film The Other Side of the Wind, which may or may not get completed in some form this year, which was shot in the early 70s, is at least half of the film is in the form of a pseudo-documentary of a 70th birthday party of a film director, in which everything you see is cutting between journalistic footage shot by Super 8, video, 16, and so on. And in fact, the film has two styles, neither of which are usually considered Wells style, the other being the film that he is just in work print form that he's screening at the party, and which we're seeing for about half of the running time of the film also, which is can only be described as a kind of arty parody of Antonioni. It doesn't actually function very well as a parody of Antonioni, but is very arty and very much of its period of late 60s, early 70s. So I want to read you another quote, which I think is very telling about Wells, from Bill Crone. Who's been the main American correspondent for Cahiers du Cinéma since the 70s or 80s. The process-oriented methods that permitted at least four Wells features and a number of short works to be left unfinished are easier to understand than they would be if we adopted the mental habits of producers, which is exactly what more and more critics today seem to be doing. But that is no comfort to those of us eager to understand, and eager as critics always are, to have the last word, which we are not about to have with this filmmaker. At least our direction is always as laid out for us. As long as one frame of film by the greatest filmmaker of the modern era is moldering in vaults, our work is not done. It is the last challenge and the biggest joke of an oeuvre that has always had more designs on us that we could ever have on it. Now, I'm not really going to talk about, or at least unless you have questions about it, about filming Othello, because that's not generally available. But it's certainly a very interesting film, which I can hope that you'll get to see eventually. Part of the problem of why it hasn't become available is that the rights to Othello are held by Wells' youngest daughter, Beatrice, and because filming Othello includes portions of Othello in it, and the rights to that film are held by Oya Kodar, who is sort of like considered an enemy of Beatrice. It's all of these sort of personal agendas that wind up interfering with our viewing possibilities. And it's unfortunate also that the versions of Othello that are available all over the world now are not the original film, but a doctored film and they've even made Wells' original version illegal, which is even crazier, but true. So you can find, on the black market, Wells' original version of Othello, but the version we have now is one that where the dialogue has been re-recorded, or not the dialogue has been remixed, but the music has been redone and the sound effects have been redone. And without even the music being done without even consulting the original score, which the family of the composer has, but they didn't bother to look them up and so on. So it's too bad. But what's really interesting about filming Othello is that when Wells refers to, he shows you the opening sequence at the very beginning of filming Othello. But every other time he shows you something from, he says he's showing you something from Othello, he's showing you his own re-edit of passages from Othello. So it's like, this is almost a perfect example of the way nonfiction becomes fiction. Because he says he's talking about Othello, but what you're seeing is a dream Othello. It's not an Othello that ever existed except in this documentary. And I think that part of that comes about because Wells could love to edit so much that he couldn't keep his hands off, you know, these films. So consequently, we have two versions of Macbeth, which actually the second one was ordered by the studio, but Wells did the edit in both cases. But we also have two versions of Othello, at least two versions, maybe more, not counting the one in filming Othello, because one thing that isn't widely known but is fascinating is Wells did a stage production of Othello in London after the film premiered in Cannes. And when he re-edited Othello before it opened in the United States, he redubbed the actress playing Desdemona with a different actress who played Desdemona on stage. So in fact, even though most people say the Othello that we have now is with Susan Clotier, the image is Susan Clotier, but the voice is that of a different actress who's dubbing the part with a different and in a different interpretation even. So that's probably why it becomes difficult to talk about what an Orson Welles work is, because because we have two Othellos, we have two Macbeths, we have many versions of Arcadian, none of which could be considered, one that was approved, none of which were approved by Welles, because he was taken off the film before it was completed. Even with Touch of Evil, where it's closer to his conception, there's still no version that exists that has his final stamp of approval on it. So this is very complicated, obviously, and we can't really refer to what we have of It's All True as an Orson Welles film, because he considered editing to be, the main aspect of the art of filmmaking, and he was never. And what we have in the documentary, none of it is edited by Welles. So at most we can have things. I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing the film again, and in fact, one thing I wanted to deal with next is something that I wrote about this documentary, which is showing, I believe, tomorrow. Is that right? Yeah.
I think today. Eu acho que hoje.
Oh.
Temos uma sessão do It's.
Yes.
Eu, infelizmente, não tenho a programação na cabeça, mas eu acho que é hoje que a gente tem uma sessão. É hoje, não é isso? Hoje às 7:30 aqui, não é isso? Às 7. Hoje às 7 horas a gente tem esse documentário sobre o É Tudo Verdade.
Okay, thanks. I just actually posted this piece of mine on my website at jonathanrosenbaum.net. If any of you are curious later, this morning. I'm one of the. This is written an introduction to the original review I did of this documentary. I'm one of the people who receives an acknowledgement in the final credits of It's All True, based on an unfinished film by Orson Welles. But in fact, I regret the contribution I made to this film. During a phone conversation with Bill Crone, one of the writers, directors, and producers, Bill told me that one of the French producers, Jean-Luc Aumière, was looking desperately for a composer for the documentary who wouldn't charge too much money. I suggested Jorge Arriagada, the Chilean film composer who at that point had written the scores for roughly 2 dozen films by Raul Ruiz, a filmmaker I greatly admired and who was also a friend, and Arriagada wound up getting hired for the job. I recall having heard that Arriagada recently worked for Ruiz because he liked to do so rather than out of any economic necessity. And this fact combined with Ruiz's own Wells worship and Arriagada's South American background made him seem ideal at the time. Unfortunately, this conclusion was based on the common Anglo-American fallacy that Latin America is something like a single homogeneous culture. The same assumption, I presume, that years later would prompt Colin McCabe, the producer at the British Film Institute, of a series of national film histories on film or video assigned to various filmmakers, to assign the whole of Latin American cinema to one Brazilian director, admittedly a very talented and knowledgeable one, Nelson Pereira dos Santos, yielding his 93-minute Cinema of Tears in 1995. In this case, my assumption that Arriagada would have been well-versed in samba and Brazilian pop music proved to be wrong. And this, his score for It's All True, whatever its own qualities, wound up having little to do with Wells' original designs for the music. I'm pretty certain that if Dick Wilson, who'd been of inestimable help to me when I was editing the interview book with Bogdanovich, this is Orson Welles, all the way up to his tragic death in August of 1991, while even keeping his physical condition a secret from me, if he had still been alive, such an era would have been averted, because Dick was very much more aware of the and familiar with the specific music that Welles had in mind. But unfortunately, the others were not. For much more material, well, I think I deal with other material in other parts of the book, but this is just a review of the film as it appeared, and which begins with a quote from Orson Welles writing to a Brazilian friend in the 1940s. Too much effort and real love went into the entire project for it to fail and come to nothing in the end. I have a degree of faith in it that amounts to fanaticism, and you can believe that if It's All True goes down into limbo, I'll go with it. I begin by saying, as perverse as it sounds, the work of art that It's All True, based on an unfinished film by Orson Welles, most calls to mind, or at least to my mind, is Vladimir Nabokov's 1962 novel, Pale Fire. Discounting its tricky forward and index, this literary tour de force consists of a 27-page, 999-line poem by the fictional dead poet John Shade, followed by 160 pages of annotation by the probably insane and certainly unreliable Charles Kimboat. By contrast, It's All True consists of about half an hour of entertaining, mainly accurate, and altogether sane commentary on Orson Welles' ill-fated three-part feature of that title, followed by an hour-long edited version of the silent rushes of one of the episodes, Four Men on a Raft, originally planned as the feature's centerpiece, edited by Ed Marks, who used a few rough outlines by Welles as his main guide. This episode has been furnished with discrete sound effects and music by Arriagada. The most significant part that's missing, and I wish the documentary prologue had pointed this out, is the narration that Welles planned to use but never wrote or recorded. One can easily tick off the major differences between Pale Fire and It's All True. A bit of a far-fetched comparison, like my earlier comparison of the 12th Night prologue with The War of the Worlds. What then are the similarities? An interdependence of text and commentary that keeps one's mind restlessly scampering between the two, unable to find satisfaction or closure in either. The uncertainty and indeterminacy of a longer section of each work, Pale Fire's commentary, It's All True's quote text unquote, in contrast to the pithy clarity of the shorter section. The presentation of two complementary and stylistically divergent forays into the same genre, fiction in Pale Fire, documentary in It's All True, that together say and mean more than either could alone, despite the fact that the synthesis is riddled with gaps and raises innumerable questions. Finally, an excruciating rift between what is present and what is absent, between the knowable and the unattainable, the graspable and the unimaginable. In short, It's All True generally does such a good job with what it has, journalistically speaking, that it winds up breaking your heart. It doesn't offer up a new or restored Orson Welles film because there never was a film. It doesn't even offer an ersatz well film cobbled together out of Wells footage, like the distressing version of Don Quixote recently released in Spain. But what it does provide is indispensable, a cogent account of what happened with the project and enough of the original footage to allow one to speculate at some length about what might have been. The film should leave you feeling vaguely unsatisfied. Anything else would have been a lie. And if it presents a quandary, it's neither the film nor the last, it's neither the first nor the last one posed by Wells' unruly career, a career that constantly brings up the question of what a work or an oeuvre actually is. Among the many film projects that Wells had in development, just after the release of Citizen Kane in May 1941, were one about Landru, a 20th century French Bluebeard, a project written for and eventually purchased by Charlie Chaplin, who converted it into Monsieur Verdoux. A life of Jesus set in America at the turn of the century, conceived as a kind of primitive Western, a political thriller centered around a fascistic news commentator, adaptations of the magnificent Amersons and Journey into Fear, and an omnibus feature called It's All True, consisting of four true stories. Originally, those four stories were a history of American jazz, a story by John Fonte about his Italian parents meeting in San Francisco, and two stories by documentary filmmaker Robert Flaherty, one about a Mexican boy's friendship with a bull called My Friend Bonito, the other about a boat captain. An anthology format had served well on radio, and he launched a new weekly show around the same principle in the fall, which, you know, there's a lot of overlap. It was called the show sometimes Orson Welles' Almanac, and Orson Welles' Almanac was also the name of the newspaper column. So he would use these things to kind of like feed off one another. In September, Norman Foster began directing My Friend Bonito in Mexico under Wells' supervision. And the following month, Wells began shooting The Magnificent Ambersons. In December, 2 weeks after Pearl Harbor, he received a telegram from the coordinator of the Federal Inter-American Affairs Office asking him to undertake a goodwill mission to Brazil to make a non-commercial film there without salary to promote hemisphere solidarity, with RKO Studios footing the bill, but the government guaranteeing up to $300,000 against potential financial losses. Nelson Rockefeller, a major RKO stockholder, and President Roosevelt, a personal friend of Wells, both urged him to accept. Rockefeller was adamant that Wells arrive in February in time to shoot the annual Rio Carnival. I want to point out that because the project never happened, and Rockefeller, for Wells, was a major culprit in what went wrong, you know, in everything getting screwed up. For those of you who've seen The Lady from Shanghai, the major villain in the film, who's a character named Grisby, played by Glenn Anders, is modeled after Nelson Rockefeller. Rockefeller called people as a, you know, like as a nickname, fella, which Grisby does also. And so it's kind of like a private joke, the same way that when Hitchcock made Rear Window, he had the main murderer played by Raymond Burr modeled after David O. Selznick, his former producer. Anyway, Wells finally agreed to the conditions offered by Rockefeller and RKO, on condition that they be allowed to finish cutting Ambersons in Rio with his editor, Robert Wise. In early January, he recalled Foster from Mexico to begin directing Journey into Fear, intending to compete Bonito himself on his way back for Brazil and incorporated into a revamped, now South American, It's All True. Speeding up both Ambersons and Journey in order to make his deadline, he finished his production work and suspended his radio show by February 1st, flew to a briefing with government officials in Washington the next day, and then proceeded directly to Miami for a 3-day marathon editing of Ambersons with Robert Wise. Then he flew to Rio, where he and his crew immediately began shooting the carnival in both Technicolor and black and white. Over the next month, Wells began to sketch two Brazilian stories to go with Benito, an account of the samba at the carnival to replace the history of American jazz, and a reenactment of an epic 1,650-mile raft journey taken the previous fall by four impoverished jangadeiros from Fortaleza to Rio to speak to President Vargas about their economic exploitation by the owners of their fishing rafts, who collected half of their weekly catch. Wells' celebration of impoverished blacks in both these stories, quite compatible with the emphasis of Benito, raised the hackles of Brazilian government officials and RKO studios executives alike, and some US government officials expressed their displeasure as well. The four jangadeiros may have become national heroes, but their activist leader, Yacaré, was considered a communist. The film hardly promised to correspond to the touristic propaganda bra Brazil the local dictatorship wanted. When Wells took his Technicolor cameras into the favelas to trace the origins of samba, he and his crew were ejected from at least one of them at Vargas's request, or at his behest, at least. Meanwhile, Wells was commissioning an extraordinary array of research into Brazilian life and culture by a large team of Brazilian, not Hollywood, writers, producing a weighty file of ambitious essays that still exists. These radical aspects of the project, elided or minimized in most previous North American accounts of It's All True, or else distorted by racist and innuendo, such as reading Wells' friendship and collaboration with blacks as simply partying or slumming, have never been forgotten in Brazil. Grand Otelo, the star of the story of Samba, whom we also see and hear 50 years later in the documentary, compared Wells to Martin Luther King when he spoke at a Wells conference held at New York University in 1988. And the very fact that such a conference was held became front page news, I'm told, in a São Paulo newspaper. Things began to go badly for Wells, not honoring its promise to send in Amberson's rough cut with Robert Wise to Rio. RKO decided to preview the film. A week after the second preview, Jacare drowned in an accident while he and the other three jangadeiros were preparing to restage the triumphant arrival in Rio for the film. Then things got even worse. Rockefeller left the RKO board of directors, and shortly after, studio president George Schaefer, the man who first lured Wells to Hollywood, had remained his strongest ally and had even come up with a title for Citizen Kane, was forced to resign. More than 45 minutes were hacked out of Amberson's by Wise and others, in part to soften some of its harshness, and some scenes were reshot or added. Then Wells' staff was summarily evicted from the RKO lot, and It's All True was halted in mid-production. Before returning to the States, Wells was permitted to shoot from mid-June to mid-July a revised version of Four Men on the Raft, without sound and in black and white, on a minimal budget and with a skeletal crew in Fortaleza, Recife, and Salvador. But when he returned to the US, no one would go anywhere near the project. And it would hardly be an exaggeration to say that Wells' career never fully recovered from RKO's mutilation and dumping of Amberson's and Journey, its abrupt scuttling of a third picture, and its well-mounted campaign depicting Wells as irresponsible and out of control, a clear attempt to justify its own actions. The following year, RKO's stationery bore the slogan, "Showmanship instead of genius," which was clearly a reference, backhanded reference to Wells. Almost 3 years passed before Wells could direct another picture, and the image of him proffered by RKO has become so well entrenched over the past half century that it's still repeated in some quarters like a comforting mantra. Critic and biographer Charles Higham devoted two full books, published in 1970 and 1985, to propounding this myth. And Robert L. Carringer's The Magnificent Ambersons, A Reconstruction, Wells' Oedipal hang-ups and his irrational denials stemming from them. I mean, but he argues that nothing could have made Ambersons an artistic success, because of Wells' Oedipal hang-ups. And And I'm saying, speaking of irrational denials, over the course of 307 pages, Carringer fails to mention it's all true once, even in a footnote, and seems to regard the entire Brazilian episode as extraneous to what happened to Ambersons, when, of course, it was central. Considering the sacred value we record the bottom line, we shouldn't be surprised that some academics like Carringer defend RKO's business sense in eviscerating Ambersons and Journey, though both movies lost piles of money anyway. After all, it was the principle of thing, the pride and honor of the studio system itself, that was at stake. This isn't to argue that Welles had any business sense or even much common sense when it came to ingratiating himself within that system. 3 months before the release of Citizen Kane, he published an article attacking the function of most producers, agents, and studio heads, and the implied threat to the system represented by his original Hollywood contract, which granted him almost unlimited control of his pictures, clearly made many in the film industry livid. While he inspired passionate loyalty from most of his staff, one suspects that his business associates, starting with John Houseman, regarded him somewhat more ambivalently. And when he was off in Brazil, his business manager was Jack Moss, and according to the late writer-director Cy Enfield, who was working for Moss at the time and who I interviewed earlier in the year before I wrote this article, many of the frantic long cables Welles sent to Moss about the re-editing of Ambersons went straight into the wastebasket, unread. Enfield also saw both the previews of Ambersons. And one thing that I think is important to point out is that even though everybody tends to say that the previews were disasters, if you actually look at all the preview cards, which still exist, there are at least a third that say that couldn't be more enthusiastic, that say this is the greatest film I've ever seen. So the point is, the studio had a vested interest in calling it a disaster and in making it a disaster, because they screened it right after a trivial wartime musical. So the audience that would come seeing another film would be anything but an audience prepared to see something as gloomy and as downbeat as Magnificent Ambersons. In any case, if Welles' troubling career carries any lesson, it's that the same delirious risk-taking that led to such unmitigated disasters paid off spectacularly in other situations, including Citizen Kane. And the dogged efforts of academics to assign a neat linear progression to Welles' oeuvre are frequently misguided, being generally based on what was released than what was filmed. When one reads that The Immortal Story in 1968 was his first color film, the dazzling extensive color Technicolor footage he shot in Brazil 26 years earlier, a little bit of which we see in It's All True, is overlooked. Other experts acknowledge that the Brazilian color footage, but assume it was devoted to the carnival, a myth that has clung to Welles' scholarship so tenaciously that some reviewers of the new documentary have been expressing doubts that the other Technicolor footage briefly visible in It's All True is Welles' footage. A subtle bias about already black and white being the only proper medium for showing poverty, a bias reflected in most documentaries and neorealist features of the 40s, may be behind this uncertainty. Similarly, many critics, myself included, have cited Othello as Welles' first independent feature. It probably is, but it might be argued that It's All True, which started out 7 years earlier as a Hollywood feature with the full studio resources of a studio, wound up independent, at least when Welles was shooting most of Four Men on a Raft, and certainly when he was trying to keep the project alive afterwards. In truth, it's a bit of both. The documentary shows us the Hollywood trickery involved in the shooting of the men on the boat, but also reveals how crude and improvised such special effects had to be. With the possible exception of Eric von Stroheim, no Hollywood figure better illustrates the incompatibility of art and commerce than Welles. Although one could also cite John Cassavetes, I think, in this list. It's an incompatibility that can easily be overlooked or rationalized If one's looking at the careers of certain giants during the heyday of the studios, figures such as John Ford, Howard Hawks, Alfred Hitchcock, and Ernst Lubitsch, but it's much harder to ignore today when the conditions that allowed such careers to flourish no longer exist. And people who cite Citizen Kane as a counterexample tend to minimize the fact that on first release it played only at independent theaters and lost money. It was never previewed and came very close to being destroyed by Louis B. Mayer and other studio executives when they offered to reimburse RKO for the total cost of the picture if they would burn the negative. If RKO president George Schaefer hadn't defied the Hollywood community by rejecting the offer, we wouldn't have the film today. But most film moviegoers and reviewers would prefer to ignore this incompatibility because the business couldn't be run as smoothly if they didn't. And one of the most popular rationalizations for ignoring the incompatibility of the two is retrievability. According to this myth, it doesn't really matter how many movies are mutilated by producers or distributors because they can always be restored later on laser, on video or otherwise. But it's absurd to apply such a myth to Wells. We can't restore Emerson's because all of the cut footage was destroyed by the new RKO management in late 1942. And by the way, even though there are still people who think that there's the footage still might be in Brazil, unfortunately, and Wells, this is something that did come up in my conversation with Wells. He said he was sure they destroyed it all. And in fact, the other print that was that they might have sent to Brazil was sent back to Hollywood, and we have the date of when that was destroyed also. And we can't restore It's All True because it was never allowed to exist. That's why the documentary It's All True needs its awkward subtitle, based on an unfinished film by Orson Welles. Without it, the film sounds like a resurrection. And all we have now of the original film are some of the raw materials. Those that weren't damaged, those that weren't dumped into the Pacific Ocean when the space of the studio storage facilities was needed. Not only is most of the carnival footage missing, but almost all of the editing Wells did in subsequent years, whenever he was attempting to persuade a studio to resuscitate the project in some form. At one point, he even purchased the footage himself, but then he was unable to keep up the storage payments. And so we're getting a little late in time, so I'm just saying, I'm basically thinking that most of the Bonita footage appears to have survived as well, but we have only one sequence of it, and It's All True, a lovely depiction of the blessing of the young animals in a village church. And all this undeveloped footage will turn to dust if funds for preservation, its preservation aren't made available. And this is still true, I should say. Because I gather we're running a little late, I want to just jump, if I can, from It's All True to its supposed dialectic opposite, F for Fake, and show you a brief sequence and then comment on it, because both of them involve very interesting forms of trickery, even though they're supposedly, in their own way, quite straightforward. So maybe we could look at that footage now, and then I can talk about it briefly. At one point, it uses the term fractioners. There's no such word in the English language as fractioners. I think almost everybody who knows English reads it as practitioners. That's what Gary Graver was supposed to have written on the can, but he was in a hurry and he didn't know how to spell, so he wrote practitioners. Wells noticed the mistake and decided to keep it. And it's significant because we read it as practitioners. Well, a similar thing goes on in the girl watching sequence with Oya Kodar, because we're seeing her fragmented in little bits and pieces of her throughout the sequence, until very briefly at the very end, we think we're seeing the full figure of Oya Kodar. In fact, we're not seeing the full figure of Oya Kodar. We're seeing her sister in the same dress, her sister Nina, so that we're persuaded, because when we're finally relieved, you know, like to see the full figure, that we're seeing her, but we're not seeing her. So in both cases, the imagination of the audience is in direct collaboration with Wells' trickery. If we didn't have imaginations and we weren't filling in the blanks, he wouldn't have been able to operate. And so that's why this fulfills the program I mentioned in my opening quote, that that's when, he said, the theater becomes a social act. And for me, this is when cinema becomes a social act. Anyway, thank you very much.
Nós temos tempo para mais uma ou duas perguntas. Então, tem uma aqui. Aqui na primeira fileira, por favor. Aqui primeiro. Depois atrás. Para o senhor de óculos.
Yes. Rosenbaum, é uma pergunta sobre o título do filme que você mencionou, do F for Fake, porque você disse que o filme teve vários títulos, né? Hoax, em alguns momentos o filme era chamado de question mark, ou apenas com o símbolo question mark, né? E que por sugestão da Oya Koder, o filme ficou com o título definitivo de F for Fake. Quando o filme é exibido na França, ele ganha o título em francês de Verdades e Mentiras, Vérité ou Mensonge, que é o título pelo qual o filme é conhecido aqui no Brasil também. Verdades e Mentiras em português, a partir do título francês. Eu queria saber a sua opinião, se a gente não tem uma perda de ambiguidade do título original em inglês para a tradução francesa e, portanto, para a tradução brasileira, quando a gente pensa no título original, que esse F stands for fake, o fake pode ser ao mesmo tempo o ato, né, o verbo to fake, pode ser o adjetivo fake e pode ser o substantivo fake.
Yes.
As três coisas. E quando você pensa simplesmente vérité à mensonge, você perdeu essa ambiguidade, né? Você acha que a gente pode escolher uma das três, o verbo, o ato, o verbo, o substantivo ou o adjetivo, ou é interessante manter as três no, na ideia do título? Obrigado.
Well, that's a very interesting point you make, and I agree with you, but I should add that I saw one of the first press screenings in Paris of F for Fake, and at the time, I think it was called just fake when I saw it originally. I remember that the handout given to the press said that it was very puzzling. It said written by Olga Palinkas, and I thought, who's that? And you know, and it turns out that's the real name of Oya Koder. Wells got her to change her name to make it a little more user friendly. To Oya Koder, and in fact, the script is partly written by her. The whole Picasso episode was written by her, and I mean, she's someone who people don't know what to do with her. But you know, since I know her much better than I only met Wells for 1 hour, but I've known Oya since shortly after Wells died. People are very confused by her as a figure, but she was the only one of the women in Wells' lives who became a very active and very active collaborator on many, many projects. Not only did she co-write also The Other Side of the Wind, that title is also her title. And I think because she's outside the world of cinema, people are even further confused, you know, by her role in a lot of these things. I even discovered on my own, because she didn't tell me this, but I guessed it and then had it confirmed by her that she, even one of the sequences in The Other Side of the Wind was actually directed by her also. And she did the set designs for a lot of things because she's a sculptor and an artist herself. And so I think it becomes very confusing because usually Wells is the ultimate figure of the auteur in people's minds. And so they can't think, it's kind of hard to make room for the idea of Wells and somebody else, you know, being in the auteur on some of his films. But I think that one of the things that's very interesting about his interest in and his use of Oya Koder is that I thought when I first saw the film, oh, this is an old man sort of showing off his beautiful, sexy girlfriend. But in fact, Wells himself was an exhibitionist, and he identified with Oya. I think that's part of the, so it's not simply that, it's also she becomes Wells' representation of himself in a funny sort of way in some of these, in some of the films in which she appears. Most obviously in the film he was never able to shoot more than a few sequences of, The Dreamers from Isaac Dennison, where she plays a woman who, a former opera singer who goes out into the world and leads different lives as different people and gets involved with different men. And, you know, it's sort of like it becomes a person who goes through several different identities that was clearly very, it was a very personal project for Wells, but it obviously made sense to have Oya play the part.
Jonathan, no seu texto sobre os filmes ensaísticos e as ficções documentárias do Wells, que você retomou parcialmente hoje na segunda parte da sua conferência, você estabelece uma tipologia, vamos dizer, das interações no corpus wellesiano entre documentário e ficção, né? E essa tipologia foi precedida por uma lista de filmes em que a solução de combinação entre documentário e ficção era feliz, dava lugar a resultados progressistas. E nessa lista toda é composta de filmes que são posteriores aos primeiros trabalhos do Wells. Eu queria te perguntar, hoje aqui respondendo a uma pergunta, você lembrou o caso do Méliès e dos Lumière, que seriam exemplos do quão artificial é a separação estanque entre ficção de um lado e documentário do outro, na tradição do cinema. Eu queria te perguntar o seguinte, você percebe no trabalho de algum cineasta uma antecipação mais específica dessas modalidades de conjugação entre ficção e documentário que você percebe no trabalho do Wells? Quer dizer, seria possível remeter essa combinação de documentário e ficção no Wells ao trabalho de algum cineasta específico que o precedeu? Ou ele está inaugurando uma maneira nova de fundir esses dois elementos?
Oh, no, I think there are many cases of filmmakers who anticipate Wells in this. One obvious one would be Jean Renoir, who is one of Wells' own favorite filmmakers, because every Renoir film is, in a way, almost like a documentary about the actors in a certain way. And not only the actors, but the experience, they're almost like becomes a documentary about the experience of making a film, which is a quality you find much later in Robert Altman, Altman's films, for example. It's very obvious that you have this crossover in a film like Greed by Eric von Stroheim, who was someone else that Wells revered and was good friends with Stroheim, actually. Because you had not just filming on real locations, but, you know, having the actors go through in real life what they were going through, you know, their characters. And an attempt to break down that kind of, you know, like that barrier. And even the idea of authenticity for Stroheim, when it was very important that everybody wear the proper clothes and that the sets were exactly accurate and all of this. It seems to me that the whole idea of authenticity had something to do with, you know, documentary authenticity. Those are two examples. I think, I'm sure one can come up with others. I mean, nowadays, it seems to me that it's hard to think of major filmmakers who don't have some aspect of this dialectic. I mean, I find it in Bellatar. I find it in Jia Zhangxie in China. It's certainly there in Kurostami. In fact, Kurostami's, I co-wrote a book with an Iranian friend on Kurostami, and I opened that book with the same quotation from Orson Welles that I use today, about you know using the audience's imagination and all of that and you know it being a theater being a social act when you do that. So I think certainly, and Iranian cinema in general mixes documentary and fiction in all kinds of interesting ways. One interesting paradox in Iranian cinema, which I think highlights some of these paradoxes, is that it's illegal to show women outdoors without their, you know, scarf and hijab. But of course, if you see in a movie a woman at home, she wouldn't be wearing her hijab. But in a film, she would have to be wearing it. And this is why most Iranian films take place out of doors, to avoid that contradiction, because it would be unrealistic to have a woman wearing it at home, but also illegal. So it becomes a real problem. And so therefore, it seems to me that this automatically means that you start getting involved in fiction, even if you're doing a documentary, obviously. But I think anybody who's made documentary knows mm-hmm. that they're fictional devices. You know, even when simple things, when I've been interviewed in interviews for, and they ask me to repeat what I just said, but more slowly, you know, and so on. Obviously, that already becomes fictional.
Infelizmente, a gente vai ter que encerrar. Eu vou agradecer demais ao Jonathan Rosenbaum por estar aqui e ter aberto essa 14ª conferência. Nós vamos recomeçar às 14h com a mesa sobre cinema brasileiro. Antes disso, o Felipe Loca, que é o coordenador de produção da conferência, que eu agradeço o trabalho, Felipe, obrigado por tudo. Eu acho que ele tem uma atividade para com o público. Antes, vamos nos despedir do Jonathan. Jonathan, muito obrigado.